So let's start. This week, we're very lucky to have Professor Richard Freeman, who is a scholar who knows about labor markets, labor market institutions across countries as well as in the United States, who's the most accomplished and most knowledgeable that I know. And so we're very lucky to have him here. And as usual, we'll give him 5 to 10 minutes to start us out and say a little bit about labor market institutions, technology, and some of the ideas in the paper of his that you read. And then, as usual, we'll open it up for discussion. Thank you, Richard.
So I've avoided the PowerPoints for the 5 to 10 minutes, and I'll just make comments. And if you disagree violently, wait till after the 10 minutes, and then we can debate. So I believe we're at the outset of a massive technological change that is going to upset jobs and human well-being in the next 30 or 50 years. The timing is uncertain for this. The big reason why I believe this is that we're now developing, quote, machines, artificial intelligence, software that has comparative advantage over humans in the kind of tasks that we have traditionally had. So previously, machines replaced large part of brawn, risky activities. You don't want someone to go down a coal mine. That's really bad. You don't want a fireman to go into a burning building. You would rather have robots. Those are very dangerous and scary jobs. We haven't yet got the robots to replace the fire people, and we still have coal miners. But those, all of those kind of activities, these things, that's fine. Now the machines are beginning to challenge us in our thinking. And if you accept the view that comparative advantage of people means that we would hold good jobs and the machines do the nasty work and the bulk work, and that's beginning to change, then you're going to see a tremendous shift in the income distribution. We've already seen, of course, huge inequalities developing, and this should give an extra kick to those inequalities. Most of the things you read in the papers about the jobs are, the robot is coming to take your job. I put little faith in that. I would instead say, the robot is coming to take your income. It's not your job so much. Even when the Go robot, the Go machine, played the human Go player, they actually had someone move the Go pieces on the board with fingers, because humans still have a comparative advantage. Our fingers and our thumb can beat out any robot. And there's any number of other places where it's clear. But that finger movement person is probably not paid a whole lot of money to do the job. The real work was being done by the robot. So maybe 3 or 4 years ago, first got interested in this, and I wrote this little paper, Who Owns the Robots Rules the World, which meant to capture the notion that the key thing was who was going to get the income that the robots are going to be making. And if you're going to be a fancy lawyer, make lots of money, and the robot comes and it's your robot, you got a pretty good life. The robot does the work and you make the same money. But if somebody else owns the robot, it's different. And I assume everyone here knows that capital income is incredibly more unequally distributed than labor income. So it's magnitude So if this is going to be a shift of income to capital, that's to something way more unequal than all the study, all the labor things. Okay, so that's what the big theme of this. Look to the incomes, look for the comparative advantage, and then what are we going to see? I don't have massive evidence for you, so that could be criticized. Some of my colleagues have criticized for this. But that's because this is just the beginning. And everything that I've seen since writing that first paper, Who Owns, the one I distributed to you, Redux, is really, it's just strengthened my beliefs that this is the way the world is going. So I put there the three laws of robotics. Some of you may associate that term with someone else. Who? Isaac Asimov, of course. And I'm a big fan of his when I was a kid. So it's a pleasure to work on this topic, science fiction. The law one seems to me absolutely what is going on is the substitution between humans and robots is getting more. Previously, the robots could not substitute for us in a lot of mental tasks. Now they can do mental tasks as humans. The place that shocked me and shocked a lot of other people was when the AlphaGo machine beat the human Go player. I assume some people here play Go. I play Go. I played very diligently until I played against a Korean graduate student and I got stomped so badly. I really realized, boy, that the extent to which you build up knowledge about the pieces and where to go and so on. And you always said, well, chess is an easy game for the computer to beat us in, and Go is a really hard one. Ding, that machine beat Lee Sedol, they beat the Chinese champion, and I forgot which of the two champions was sort of crying at the end because it's incredible. How did the machine manage to do that? Because it lives in a digital space, it played itself far more times than any human in their lifetime could play with other humans. So it built up incredible experience, the same way I like to think the Korean student who beat me badly was not that he was much smarter than me, but that he had many more years of experience in game playing than I did. So at the same time, there were a couple of other developments that moved in the same place. There were two AI programs that beat humans playing poker. Poker is incomplete information. And I first thought when they said, poker, well, it must be you got a good camera. And you know when I'm bluffing in poker, my face looks a little uncertain, who knows what. And the poker thing, no, it didn't use any of that information. It just made inferences about when the humans were bluffing or whatever it was. And that got less attention than the AlphaGo machine, but was very striking because it means incomplete information where the machine ultimately, need not win, if I can phrase it right. We didn't think it did. Third, for the sake of the law students here, I even brought a copy. You may or may not know this study done in London, I think it was 2017. But I got I just copied the front page of the article. It says, comparing the performance of artificial intelligence to human lawyers in the review of standard business contracts. Anyone here familiar with that study? Or you should quickly look at it. Because what it said was that we now have an AI program that can beat out top lawyers, law students, in finding some problems in these standard business contracts. So if you think you're going to make a living of going over your contracts and finding weak things, no, the robot is going to beat you out at that. Okay, so that's, we have some evidence of that. Then people would sometimes say to me, oh yeah, so the Go robot, the Go AI can beat the human, but you can beat that robot at chess. Of course, it's only a Go robot. And the Roomba vacuum cleaner can clean your house perhaps better than you can, but it can't wash the dishes for you, so on and so on. And my answer I would say, but you should look at how many occupations and skills different specialized robots are being invented. And then if you have an ensemble or portfolio of robots, you name anything you want to do, and I will go to my portfolio and pull out the specific robot, the specific software package that will beat you. So it's all about ensembles. It never dawned upon me that we could have a general learning robot that doesn't need any of the specialized things that the AI robots were built in. I flip between AI and robots, but it's the brains of the robot more than the machine part. And that's when we had AlphaGo. And AlphaGo, the article just came out, I think this Christmas, in Science. And this is a machine built by a Google, built by people of a small British company that was bought by Google. And the success of their research may slow now that they're owned by a giant company. That's very possible. But this machine would know nothing on Friday, and they would teach it the rules of chess, what you're allowed to do, and by Monday it could beat any human in chess. They could do the same thing with Go. They did the same thing with Shogi. The idea is any strategic board game you could imagine, this machine was capable of learning in a weekend to beat any human. A lot of people, I'm not the only person, just was like, oh boy, that just says in many, many tasks that we never would have dreamed the machine will be there. And you don't even need the specialized portfolio of machines, because the machine is capable of incredible learning. And that, I think, just takes bang, bang, bang. That's the Alpha Zero machine. Now you say, okay, so they're getting to be better and better substitutes for us and can beat us in lots of brain tasks that we thought were good. What about the price of these machines? Well, any economist will tell you technological change means lower prices. Sometimes the price remains the same and the quality of the machine gets better. So computers, $1,000 roughly for certain kinds of computers, but they get more and more powerful every year. Same thing is true of your cell phone. Per unit of quality, technical change means reduced cost. It's just definitional and clearly the case. And if you look at the evidence on the price of robots, huge drops for these ARM robots that they use in some of the factory work. For robots, pretty much the same, prices come down 70-80%. And as they increase production, the scale, the prices will keep coming down. So now you say the machine is more substitutable for us, and it's getting cheaper over time. Well, then you say, what's going to happen to our wages? For a lot of us, the wages are going to be bounded by what the machine can do, and will long-term be reduced. So law one says greater substitution. Law two says the cost of the machine goes down, and that bounds what they'll be willing to pay us to do. And then the law three is who owns the robots. property ownership becomes extraordinarily important. Okay, that is the basic story of this whole area. And then when I go sometimes to different groups and say, well, we better think about different ways to distribute income so that the average person gets some rewards from this technological change. I've talked to the various unions, and they say, well, collective bargaining, these institutions. They're institutions that have worked reasonably successfully in the past. It's hard to see them working so successfully in the future. Maybe they can have a rebirth, but that's tough to see. The place where I put most stress as an institutional change is greater worker ownership of the shares of their firm, and then greater ownership of mutual funds, capitalism more broadly, by equivalent of TIA, CREF, or CalPERS, big funds. They don't have to be pension funds where workers' money is in. So that if more income goes to capital, we either in our own workplace benefit, or just as owners of part of the whole capitalist system, that would work. If you're very, conservative, neoclassical, and you start going, this is going to destroy the capitalist whatever it is, there's a very important neoclassical theorem that Danny said, maybe I shouldn't mention, but I just have to. The Coase theorem, which essentially says that any time a group of workers and firms or people get together, they will always seek to get the maximum, most efficient point, and the whole thing is over the distribution. And in the Coase, there's zero transactions cost. And so ultimately, we're not going to reduce output, because then we got less to share. And so eventually, and that's what a good institution does. It redistributes income towards its own group without destroying the efficiency or harming the efficiency. And in the case of the studies I've done over the years with trade unions, that's basically what they do. And in employee ownership, it looks like they actually increase the well-being of the somewhat more efficient operation in the situation. So that's the nature of the institutions and what I think is the problem. I'll conclude, just say a little bit about more recent research we're doing, because I would have come with a big PowerPoint and all kinds of stuff if I had masses of data and could just beat you into the ground so you couldn't disagree. But don't have that, because you don't have that now, because obviously these machines are just developing. The robots, we had 40,000 robots in the U.S., and we have a million immigrants coming in. So it's just, the robots just aren't overwhelming our job market. They're overwhelming nobody's job market. The most robot intense place in the world is South Korea at the moment, robots per worker. And Korea's at the forefront, a lot of this stuff. But Korea's not being overwhelmed. These are exponential trends. And so you can't really get evidence in a deep way. So we've done some work trying to look at not straws in the wind, that sounds a little too weak, but taking the places that have been the most impacted and seeing, do you see some evidence consistent with the story? And George Borges and I looked at the robots by industry in the U.S. over time, and we found that, yes, industries that brought in more robots reduced the pay of workers relative to others, and employment also fell, which in economics means the demand curve shifted down. that needn't be the case, but it is the case. By needn't be, you can imagine situations where the robot is very complementary to the worker, but it appears not to be the case. What we're now doing is starting a big project on software, because an incredible large fraction now of our capital stock is not machines and plants, it's intangible knowledge economy software. And the software, when you start looking at, this is now not the games, but business to business software, it's doing tasks that accountants have done. It's making decisions that human resource people would make. It can help people, it can be complementary, or it can be substitute. We gotta know. And then I think we have to know what it is that drives the direction of this software investment. That's, technology is not God-given. Technology is made by people given incentives. And what's the incentive for me as a software company to make a software that'll make you better worker or that'll get rid of you? And so that's just a project we're just beginning. But it seems to me that's very, very cogent for this. We have also looked at the, it's called ONET data, which is the Department of Labor of the US, uniquely in the world, has gathered large amount of data on what people do at their job and what skills they say are necessary and what, et cetera. And we've done, the first time anybody's, I'd say, dared to do this, because everybody knows this data is kind of slightly flaky. So we looked at it over time. And what you quickly see is more and more literally every job has more and more computer software interactions going on. You take a classical secretary, now a secretary, I say she, because most of them are women, but secretary's job is, they'll do the accounts receivable because they have a program in front of them. And there used to be a special clerk for that. And there'll be, so if that occupation is gonna do well, it's that they're gaining more and more things because they are using the computer as their assistant, or they are assisting the computer, however you want to phrase it, but they're interacting with it. So we think we already see evidence of substantial changes in what people do at their work interacting with machines. And you go to any blue collar person, delivery people, they're all connected up. And so the jobs have changed in fundamental ways. Now, somebody Friday came to me and said, you're a pessimist about the robots. And I said, no, I'm favorable to the robots. I wish I was one. but I think I'm being optimistic. And the reason is this. If the humans do nothing insane, and we just keep moving along this direction, there will be a world in which the who owns the robot rules will be true. That's a better world than a world that gets destroyed by climate change. We don't act to that. A world that gets mad dictators run wild and create wars or do whatever it is. This is a long-term thing. So you could say there are a lot of crises humans face. And like for the climate change, I think we need every machine and robot and human to prevent disaster. So the view of the robots and the AI taking over is probably it's probably in your lifetime, but probably not in any of ours. 50 years, 100 years would be the thing. A group of AI experts they surveyed AI experts, and they said all human work will be gone in 100 years. There's a band of error around that, but that means that they probably many, many tasks will have been automated, and I come back to that if we own it, it becomes, we won't be sitting in the classroom, we'll all be at beaches. I don't know. A lot of us probably just rather read books in the the library or something. But we'll be able to do whatever we want for a lot more time than we can now, even though we might feel a little, you know, not so productive, because it's clear there's a machine that does a lot of stuff better than us. Okay, that's my few minutes of introduction.
Great, thank you. Just so this is obviously a very different view of than Robert Gordon's, for example, with respect to the future and the role of innovation and robots and how important artificial intelligence will be. So, I mean, you know, one immediate question is if robots are so important, why don't the TFP numbers show it? Is that because we're not, so let me ask it to you rather than guessing at the answer. So we have, you know, supposedly all this is happening, but we don't see any, in fact, TFP growth rates are gone down.
I mean, that's the right question to ask, because the TFP numbers, if anything, are slowed down. And I have no great answer to that. I know what the answer is not. It's not that we are measuring technology outputs more incorrectly than in the past. The BLS and the people who do that stuff have gotten better, not worse, in their analyses. I think these things take a long time to adjust. If you take the accounting programs, what the firms that sell you the latest accounting programs will tell you, don't expect any improvements in productivity for 3 or 4 years. Your organization has got to adjust and learn how to deal with it, dot, 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 dot. That's punting the problem a little bit away. But I also would answer, I don't think looking back at these traditional numbers are capturing the difference in comparative advantage. Comparative advantage is going to be showing up and can show up primarily in just the redistribution of income from one group to another group, as a group, in this case from the people to the machines. The criticism you can make of that, and as you're thinking of it immediately, is, well, capital share has been going up. But it's been going up before these AI robots became important. And it would be better for the kind of story I'm telling if they just started to grow now. But there are obviously other factors that are determining things then. This is not a sole factor analysis. It says, here is something happening. I say it's not as important as the immigrants in the US economy because it's not big enough, but in what direction is it going? And I suppose if in 10 years you said TFP kept going down, and we had all these machines, because you can see the machines. It's an interesting thing. Are you more moved by seeing the machine working? And I've been in factories where there are no humans. Well, we've seen the machines beating us and all these things. To say, oh, it doesn't show up in TFP, well, maybe not yet. That's the best I could answer. I mean, Gordon,
you can hold on to that. So when you say that machines have a comparative are developing or have a comparative advantage over humans, that's almost like a more optimistic scenario than the one that you really drew out for the far distance. In a comparative advantage scenario, yes, wages fall, but there is still work to be done. Is that the scenario you have in mind, or do you literally have a scenario in mind where, in fact, jobs have gone, has disappeared, which is more like an absolute advantage, if you will?
No, I'm more of the comparative advantage.
Okay. And where will those remaining jobs be?
Well, the place where most people cited as being, and they have some evidence for this, is in interpersonal stuff. So even in take scientists and engineers. David Deming gave us a paper, my science seminar, 2 years ago, I think, which said the wages of the were falling in the science and engineering jobs that were more technical, and they were going up in those where there were more interpersonal skills involved. And I think that's correct. The Japanese would like to change that as fast as they can by building a lot of social robots, but we have not got the social robots up to speed at the moment. And that may happen. But I think the general thing is for the next, I don't know, 10, 15 years, if you become, let's say, a nurse helping, there will be a machine that will can lift the patient up if the patient is trouble, you know, you get them off the bed, you maybe not muscular person. But for all the other stuff and the human interactions, which will help the person get better, it requires a human. So there's all of that. Obviously, they're working on the social robots, particularly the Japanese, and we will see how quickly they develop. Because the Japanese, I think I say this fairly, they don't really want immigrants in their country doing a lot of jobs. We Americans, exclusive of maybe some weirdos in somewhere, really do want immigrants. And we'd rather have people come and work, and so on. And so a lot of our nurses are Filipino, in the U.S. The Japanese, not quite favorable to that. But eventually, I assume they will build the social robots too. That'll come in another wave. If by the time all these waves hit, we all have ownership, our incomes will be stabilized or rising, and we will look more, you know, favorably, I think, and not and certainly not be feel credibly threatened. I see when a worker in China, they're just putting in some robots, and they were asked the workers, "What's your response to the robot?" The workers are very happy. It means more output, and they can keep selling to the world. That means easier work for the person, because again, the robots would be mostly the physical kinds of stuff. In our case, it should be, yeah, and that robot means money in my pocket, because I'm partially an owner of the whole system.
So the future of work that you foresee will be one, essentially the bulk of workers are going to be doing essentially low wage work because of demand for labor will have shrunk in, but that those sort of low wage work is then supplemented with a stream of capital income that comes from. And so it's a world where redistribution is doing most of the work, or all the work, in terms of getting us a more inclusive or a fairer society, but not the participation of workers in directly in the benefits of more productive jobs.
Yes. Where the redistribution, though, is not seen as a government coming in and taxing and taking away, but be seen as a normal right of citizens, because the technology and the system is created and produced by all of us. There's so much knowledge, and knowledge is not a normal private good. The best example, I got two examples, I suppose. The best one for Americans is Alaska. The Alaska Provident Fund, it takes money from the state oil and other lands, has created a big global mutual fund, and every citizen gets dividends. Every citizen was getting up to $2,000. They've had some shenanigans or things, budget promises. They're now getting $1,000. I think it's back going up now to $1,200. And everybody in that state, including the most right-wing people, swear that this is the right way to do things. So you built it into the system. We have built into our system that everybody should get police protection. There should be free libraries. So it seems to me it's not a giant step to say that technology is allowing us to produce so much more, and it isn't showing up in wages the way it did in the past 100 years, and we just make sure the average person gets it in some other way. And I suppose it is. The knowledge capital is a public good created by us. What happens, and I'm not attacking anybody in particular, but the smart characters grab some monopoly power over the parts of the knowledge, and they also create, you know, they I don't want to downplay what they do in that sense, but they get the rents. And so this is just saying everybody should share in the natural rents that come from knowledge the same way everybody in Alaska shares in the income from their oil monies. The other country, the other place that does well with this has been Norway. But Norway does it quite differently than Alaska. They don't cut checks to people. They basically fund a lot of their social welfare state, the free libraries, the whatever it is, from the oil monies. And you know, you might say Alaska's more right-wingish kind of orientation, and Norway is more socialist orientation, but they're ultimately the same kind of answer, that it's the citizens who own this part of the of their natural resources. And the new natural resource is knowledge. And so it's making sure that everybody shares in the benefits of the increased knowledge.
I'll make three sets of remarks. And throughout, they're animated by an attitude of hope. You were hopeful, but I'm even more hopeful than you are. Meaning not that I think things will go well, but that we can make them go well if we have the right ideas. The first set of remarks is about machines and their relation to labor. The second is about the coevolution of these technologies and the occupational structure. And the third is about what we can and should do to produce the result that assures us of the greatest degree of economic growth and social inclusion. And along the way, I'm going to disagree with you at certain points. So first, on the machines. So my understanding of what a machine is and can be, even the most advanced machine, is that a machine does for us everything that we've learned how to repeat. Everything that we can represent as a formula or as an algorithm, we can embody in the physical device. And the point of the machine is then to do for us the repeatable so that we can reserve our time working with the machine in the penumbra of the not yet repeatable. We go ahead. So then what happens then in the relation of machines, even these advanced machines, robots, to work? First, the machine replaces the routine tasks, the one that we've already learned how to routinize, and does not yet, at least initially, replace the non-routine tasks. either the non-routine conceptual task or the non-routine manual task. But then the technologies begin to advance into the area of the non-routine. Now, how do they advance? It seems to me that they advance in two main ways. One way, maybe secondary, is by normalizing the situation so that the situation in which the machines are used is standardized in some way, which makes it possible for the formulaic machine to work. The second way is often under the label of machine learning, the development of a non-rule-based type of inference. So the standard formulaic machine is rule-based, the formula, the algorithm. And now a way is discovered to jump directly from a deep collection of data to an operation without passing through the intermediate stage of rule-based inference. That's what the logician sometimes called abduction, by contrast to deduction or induction. So we could call this quasi-formulaic. But something is left to the human mind, which even the quasi-formulaic machine cannot accomplish. And that is what we call the imagination. So the mind as the imagination can see something, can discover something, can develop a different way of thinking about something that doesn't make sense given its established methods and presuppositions, and then develop retrospectively the methods and presuppositions that make sense of what it has discovered. That's the imagination. And contrary to the claims of the proponents of generalized artificial intelligence, it seems that not even in principle can a machine do that. No matter how powerful it may be, and no matter how able to defeat us handily in activities like the game of Go. Well, that's as to the machines. And that suggests that a vast space remains, even in the highest development of these technologies, for our partnership with these creations of ours. Now I come to the second set of remarks, and the second set of remarks is about the coevolution of the technologies and the occupational structure. So a common view would be that the overall effect of these technologies on the occupational structure would take a U-shape, that it would hollow out the middle of the occupational structure and produce a series of jobs at the top and at the bottom, low-skill jobs in which there is no complementarity with the machines. It's like a residue. And then at the top, the high-skill conceptual work. But I've been studying the writings of your, of you and your colleagues about these things empirically, and it seems that a great deal of what we know fragmentarily doesn't confirm this idea of the U-shape. So at the bottom, it's true that there is residual work with no technology that only the most desperate would undertake. But there's something else that David Auder, for example, calls the last mile. So there's a technology that does something, and there's a last step that has to be complemented by the human worker, like putting the groceries on the shelf. That's different from just the residue of the lowest skill, lowest paid work. Then we come to the middle of the occupational structure, and it seems that at the middle of the occupational structure, despite some hollowing out, there is a surprising resilience of a certain kind of complementarity between work and these machines. And it corresponds to what Larry Katz has called the new artisans. So it's a combination of technologically equipped problem solving with personal interaction. For example, the nurse practitioner that you referred to, but also a series of traditional tradespeople like electricians or plumbers who increasingly take on the practices and mindset of these new artisans because they do this technologically equipped problem solving in a dense context that also requires judgment. And then at the top, in the last few decades of now of this century, what seems to be most surprising is that the high-skill, high-paid occupations that involve complementarity with these machines seem to have stopped expanding, contrary to the prediction of the U-shape. And we have to understand why. So I've read what your colleagues say. It's a lot of special pleading, ad hoc explanations. The most persistent cause that is invoked to explain this is a mysterious stop in the investment in these technologies. But that's like a circular explanation. It's a proxy for something else. And what it seems to be a proxy for is the very problem that we have discussed at length in this class, that the advanced practice of production, the knowledge economy, rather than continuing to deepen and spread, remains confined in insular vanguards that exclude the vast majority of workers and firms. That's what this idea of the mysterious stop in the investment in the higher technologies seems to suggest. Well, the result is that the empirical record doesn't appear to support what it was thought to support, which is this relentless advance of the technologies, the hollowing out, the growth at the top and the bottom. The actual record is much more ambiguous and complicated and full of transformative possibility. And that then brings me to the third set of remarks about our response. Our response calculated as any progressive response must be, to create an alternative to the path of least resistance. After all, that's the role of transformative thought and politics in the world. That's why they exist. So you emphasize in the paper that we have read the importance of ownership and the ownership of the highest technology. I see two preliminary problems that are connected. The first is the reification of the traditional property right. We know that the property right is just a bundle of different powers that were put together in the 19th century and vested in the same right holder, the owner. But they don't naturally or necessarily belong together, and they can be disassembled in any number of ways and vested in different kinds of right holders. If we simply transfer from the so-called capitalist to the worker who works in one of these capital-intensive enterprises, the ownership of these technologies, all that we're doing is reinforcing the hierarchical segmentation of the economy. Because those who work in these capital-intensive enterprises are a tiny minority of the labor force. That's not what we can mean or should mean. We have to have some more complicated solution that involves the democratization of claims of access to these productive resources broadly throughout the society, and not simply the distribution ex post of the rents. But there's another preliminary problem, which is the caution we must have to avoid the fetish of the machine, the actual physical device, and who owns it. To the machine itself may be a white elephant, and the sensible capitalist might want to do everything but own it, because after all, in 2 years, it'll be no good. It breaks down all the time and needs to be repaired. So it's not as if the actual possession of this physical device were our real aim. It's the ability to access it and to use it in some form. So simplifying, Richard, we can imagine two points of departure in this attempt to support an alternative to the path of least resistance. One is focused on the firm or the venture, and the other is focused on the individual, worker and citizen. So, and this follows up on discussions we've been having throughout the semester about the deepening and dissemination of the knowledge economy. So, for the firm or the venture, what is necessary is to reach further and further into the backward periphery of the economy, the vast mass, especially of small and medium-sized businesses that are stuck in retrograde practices and technologies, and give them access. And the access must always be to some kind of combination of advanced practice, advanced technology, advanced capability. So we've discussed here, for example, industrial and service equivalents to the 19th century agricultural extension, the instruments by which this operation of uplift would begin. And then the other main axis would be directed to the individual worker rather than to the venture. And what we would need to provide him with would always take a double form. On the one hand, with continuous skilling, the right kind of education at the outset that doesn't starkly contrast general and technical education, and that focuses technical education on higher order conceptual and practical capabilities, rather than on machine-specific and job-specific skills. And an opportunity throughout his life to change direction, not just to be reskilled, but even to change careers with the support of the state, so that we have a whole nation of experimentalists who reinvent themselves in the course of their lives, rather than allowing themselves to be mummified and to die before they die. Another aspect, the second prong of this response to the individual, is we would provide him with some package of claims to these technologies, which wouldn't necessarily take the form of the simple transfer of 19th century unified property. It would be rights to lease, rights to use, share time, any number of devices appropriately designed through the development of successive derivatives of the unified property right. After all, the financiers have learned how to construct these derivatives to their benefit. Why should the country not do it for its own benefit? And then in this way, we begin to create the cultural and institutional climate in which the democratizing alternative to the path of least resistance can flourish. And then your hopes will be truly justified.
Thanks. I once taught this course, and we had many discussions. Yeah. It's always great to get this type of let me answer, because some I think is correct and some I don't think is correct. It started with what's the machine not being creative. It all depends on how we want to define creative. But there will in the next 10 years be a best-selling novel written by a machine. novels. And then there's a part of the machine that is meant to capture what the human taste is. And the machine will pick out the novel that best fits all the information it has on tastes. And when they're gathering all your personal information and things, that is to partly help them develop products to sell to you at the highest price that they can get away with. And so there was pretty much among this AI expert group, the New York Times novel thing was just easy. And imagine if I gave you a poem. And I would say, guess whether this poem was made by a machine or made by a person. We have sufficiently powerful poem-making algorithms together with a taste picking, you know, so the machine learns that, yeah, people like something that rhymes at the end and has this meter or whatever it will be. So you may not want to count that as creative, but in the marketplace, that is coming, and that is the same, my thing of the Go machine. One of the things the Go players are now doing is studying the moves made by the Go machine, because they could not figure out, you know, how it figured out to do something that would then, you know, 60 moves in the future turn out to be pieces at exactly the right place. And that's, you know, the machine, as you say, just does it in some sense. And the players are trying to understand why. And I don't know how success they have had, but really looking upon the machine's activity, there's got to be some deeper understanding as to why it did. Maybe they will figure that out. Maybe they won't. The machines that are meant to prove theorems, which is another human thing, they have not done very well. I mean, there are some machines that can prove theorems in mathematics, but those are purely count theorems. You know, there's a zillion possibilities. I know it's exactly a zillion. No human's going to go through all the zillion possibilities, but the machine can do that, and that proves they do. But truly creative mathematical proof, that they haven't got that. So, but I would not rule out at all the machines moving more and more to things that you couldn't tell if it was created by a person or a machine. They're painting things. You can go to their websites that have all this machine art and machine this and machine that. And there's some artists work with the machines, so it becomes a partial thing. The other aspect of the creativity in the machines are the other way around. We become cyborgs. So I become partially machine. One of the advantages the machine has over me and everybody else here is, let's say, it can go to the cloud and instantly look at zillions of cases if it's a doctor doing something or a lawyer. Okay, put a chip up here, and you may or may not know Elon Musk, who's slightly crazy, but he's got a company on the West Coast that is working on cyborgs. We'll see what happens, but putting chips into people is, we regard it as absolutely good thing if it's your arm is cut off and we can stick a mechanical arm and we connect it to your brain and now imagine both your arms, both your legs, more of your body parts replaced, you become a cyborg kind of machine. So I think the machine's getting more like the humans and the humans getting more like the machines is a definite possible. But I agree with the occupation thing. My interpretation of what's going on at the top is a little different. I think what's happened, and I think David Deming's work is quite, let's say, consistent with this, is that a lot of the highly technical things that people use to make money as high-powered professionals, suddenly we've got an algorithm that does that, and it's devalued some types of high-paying skills. You know, we choice between a doctor or a robotic machine to look over all my things, I would choose the machine. Doctors' memories may fail. Doctors don't have access to millions of cases. The machine does. Doctor working with the machine is probably best, because then the doctor cannot forget anything. The machine will not allow, the machine will spat out. There are 600 cases like this, so maybe it's this ailment rather than that ailment, and so on. And what they do, when you have a super doctor, what you would do is you try to build a machine that would mimic that doctor's choices, so that you would ultimately say, here's the super doctor, he or she. My sister's a wonderful doctor, and she's great at diagnosis. That's her biggest thing. She's just got good. So build a machine that can mimic her supervised learning machine, and then fine. And if she was extremely highly priced, I'm sure the hospital, doctors are well paid as it is, not parents, but if she were millions of dollars, they would figure on getting an algorithm to try to do that. At the bottom, you're exactly right, but you picked the example of grocery, putting that up. That's not a high wage job to put groceries up. And so you're going to need supplemented income from some other sources if that's the kind of low skill job you're doing. People at the bottom of the American income distribution, almost every country, need supplementary things in any case. They need police protection that they could never pay for. They need health insurance. So this is just, we just have to do that.
Well, it could disappear, right? So in other words, this bottom of the last mile could disappear, and everyone could become like those new artisans.
But some of them are not doing fancy work. They're still doing exactly this. There's an element for the fingers. There's an element for human stuff, which is not going to be high pay. One of the professors, a British university, she said, don't worry about the robots. There's many things humans can do better than robots, which was really comparative advantage. She was a technology person. And then she said, we can run. The robots are really clunky. We can do this. And I'm sitting there saying, how much are we going to get to be paid for running and for doing the kind of stuff? So I think we absolutely need the supplementary things for people. There will be jobs that humans have comparative advantage of, and it won't be too much pay. For the guys in the middle, you're absolutely right. You talk to various union craftsmen, they are using stuff that you would never believe 10 to 15 years they do. If you were a bricklayer, you have, and your eyes are beginning to get, you have to line the bricks up or something. And you're not, they now have some eye thing that they'll put on, which gives a little, virtual reality, something that tells you about the bricks moving. And they said, we don't now need so many apprentices to help us. The senior guys have advantages in this. And one of the things the new technology seems to be doing is helping older workers more than younger workers. That's because the younger workers lived a lot on brawn, and brawn was the first thing to go. But I think the brains are coming along. You're always best on the responses because you're thinking about the future. There is a great technology which probably does represent a large part of the future, which is the 3D manufacturing. We will make our own products through our 3D printers. Those printers are moving incredibly fast. And whether you own the printer or whether you lease something, you say, I want to make this kind of thing. You specify it, and somewhere the machine will turn out a program, giving whatever you say. And there'll be a lot more of that kind of very private development. And whether you would call it production or consumption becomes even less clear the division. It's also true that if a worker owns part of his or her own company, that cannot substitute for general social ownership of society or of the capital structure of the whole society. Because I'm with my company, and I own some shares, and I supplement my income to the best companies we have in the world, or our own companies. Maybe I get 10% more income out of capital, so most of my income still comes from work. If I got 20, 30, 40%, that's a huge risk. So any individual company, as long as companies go out of business, companies have big, great companies collapse, you don't want people to be totally tied in to their own firm. So there has to be a large fraction of ownership that is, I think the Alaska and the Norwegian, it could be any other form that we would like, but it has to be that everybody gets a share of it. And I want to see it as an old-fashioned property, right? Because I think there's a lot of sense of the old-fashioned property rights give you greater protection against a rapacious government than other things. And the tax and spend things, people start screaming and yelling, but when you say, oh no, it's my ownership right, wherever it's built into our culture, people back away. So that I think ownership gives you a little bit extra protection as a citizen than to rely upon the tax and spend policies for these distributions. Obviously, the ownership could be leasing. Any of these creative forms would be great. I suppose the reason I put so much stress on ownership in the policy thing is there's an awful lot of very conservative people who, when you cloak or say a redistribution is about ownership, they feel good about it. If you say it's about tax and spend, they hate it. And then you can get a lot more support and friends because and they're the good guys.
Well, Richard, just to clarify one point. So a theme here in our discussions about equality and distribution has been the priority of initiatives that reshape the arrangements determining the fundamental distribution of economic and educational advantage, by contrast to the retrospective correction of the inequalities through progressive taxation or social entitlement. So we're all with you on that this should have priority. The problem comes at the second stage when the initiatives reshaping the fundamental distribution are equated dogmatically with just one of its forms, which is the unified property right, which produces a series of confusions and perverse effects, as opposed to breaking it up and inventing a whole series of forms of claims and of access.
No, that's right. As you said, the financiers have had multiple ways of doing that that have led us into disaster, and may lead us into another disaster in the next decade or so. And to do it in a way that actually reduces the risk of a financial contagion.
Oh, sorry. You still hear me? I've no problem with going further steps down the road of defining your claims or your rights in multiple ways. I suppose there's a practicality as to how much you can push the system. If you can get it going in the right direction, then presumably you can be adding and improving things, and that's in that's fine. I'm not against I'm for that. I suppose is the right way to do this. I had one other comment just about the small firms, because you said the small firms are the ones that tend to be the biggest innovators in our society, and you want to give them the extra technologies and things, as you said, like agriculture extension. But I'm leery when the, or maybe we should be happy, I don't know, when Google buys up the company that makes the DeepMind was the name of the company.
You're talking about the small firms as startups, but of course the vast majority of small firms are archaic family businesses. You're separating off the elite of small business.
Yes, but I don't think you should think of family businesses as invariably being archaic in
the vast majority.
Yeah. I'm sure a lot are. I mean, the big problem they have in our state, and I'm sure everywhere else, is my family business was a restaurant. And I'm now retiring, and my kids are college graduates, and they don't want to take over the restaurant. The restaurant closes. So part of the whole employee stock ownership plan deal was to say, don't close your small, successful operating business. sell it to your workers, and we actually give you a tax break. Sell it to your workers, and that's been really quite successful. So you will see a lot of small firms. They may be archaic. No, the founder and the family are getting old, and they want to go to something else. But the workers are sitting there and saying, "Okay, this is my skill. This is my thing," and they will think new thoughts about how to do. To do stuff, so I'm still more favorably inclined towards some of the small firms than some of the giants that I'm working right now with one of the giant technology firms, and I'm keeping thinking of if I really want to get something done, I need a small startup, not by me. I mean, I need to find a small startup that could do the work that the big guy goes through. So many archaic stuff. You need to. I mean, the U.S. government, DARPA, you need to give money out, not the National Science Foundation or the Defense Department.
So I think, it seems to me that there is a, let me try to outline what I think is the key difference in the background conditions with respect to the future of technology that you each have based your arguments on, and then I'm going to try to stake out a middle ground and see, because I don't know where exactly I am. But it seems, Richard, you're saying that there is this inexorable trend for robots to take the place of humans or to substitute for humans virtually in every task, in every part of the economy. If that is your, underlying view of where technology is going, then indeed, the only option left is to really ask the question: who's going to own the robots? Who's going to own the technology? Because work, the future of work, is one where there is very low-paying work that's around, and that has to be substituted by. Increased by a stream of payments that will come from the capital stock, largely intangible, in the form of intellectual property. I think Roberto was resisting this view, which thinks of technology as or robots inexorably taking the place of humans, and maybe let me put it. Maybe the argument is somewhat different form, but I think as a friendly version of a different argument, but it's friendly to it, which is to say that you can think about human imagination in a particular form of human needs being sort of essentially infinite, and they take infinite forms. In the language of economics, that there is a potentially infinite number of tasks, the inexorable tendency you've described, which is the tendency of robots to replace for humans in every existing task, can be potentially offset by a sufficiently rapid expansion of those needs or of those tasks. which is, of course, you know, the point that, you know, the Dharana Jamolo's framework about sort of what's the impact of technology on future employment and wages is that there is this race between how fast robots are substituting for humans in existing tasks versus, you know, how many additional tasks are being created. And why does the new tasks matter? Because every task requires at least one person to write the code for that. And so, in other words, you know, in the language of, you know, we've used examples from Go, chess, poems, novels, right? These are all existing tasks, and we're getting very good at sort of, and a machine can produce these. But, you know, entertainment can be virtually infinite. And every time there is somebody has to come up with the idea of a new type of entertainment, and then somebody, at least one person, will have to write up the code for how the machine is going to learn to produce that entertainment, that kind of entertainment, without any human labor input. And that's just from the, you know, sort of, you know, the example from entertainment, but obviously, you know, can imagine these tasks expanding in the production sphere as well. So that would be a world where, you know, imagination is coming in because, you know, we haven't imagined everything that's, you know, possible right now, and therefore there's potentially, you know, an infinite variety of future tasks not yet imagined, but imaginable, which is going to then create, you know, sort of continued an increasing demand for labor in these imaginative tasks, which then may provide sort of a different, for the possibilities of a different kind of future where people are participants in the productive sphere, in a broader way, in the generation of these tasks that workers are not simply being replaced by machines. They're being replaced by machines in the pre-existing tasks, but they are diversifying into these new tasks, and you know, everything is happening very, very rapidly, but it's not one necessarily where, and if you believed in the possibility of that world, you would say that the only solution is not simply to socialize machines or intellectual property, but to ensure that in fact larger and larger parts of the workforce have the capacity to engage in these imaginative activities, and that the form of the organizational form of firms, especially those the most productive ones, have to be sufficiently integrated with the rest of society that this is much more of a collective effort for society at large, rather than one that remains bottled up in the most advanced parts of the economy. But that's a different vision of the future.
Obviously that's a possible future, and the race between the tasks that the machine doesn't do and the tasks that it does do cheaper than we can do them is a totally legitimate to pose the thing in that way. I would imagine if there's some new task that requires me, the owner, to hire you at a high wage, I'm going to talk to my programmer over here and see how quickly we can get rid of you, or your wage, drive your wage down. So there'll be, yeah, a race of new desires and new whatever it is, and we will always try to get the costs down, and we have a lot of technology to do that, way beyond what we ever would have had before. You know, it's since we're talking about the future, it is possible, and the kind of evidence that we would need to make some judgments. I mean, right now, I'm not sure the software packages and the new machines and the AI, how complementary versus how competitive it is going to be. I believe that if it's very complementary and the wages of one set of workers goes up a lot, some other people will be saying, I can make money by replacing the set, and there may be a point where they can't replace humans. And my guess is, though, that it's going to be not in the highest paying, best activities, but could be. But there won't, and then there won't, just can't be too many people, though, in this super thing of thinking of new tasks that other people can't, that the machines can't do. Most people, I think, their creativity and their things are about their personal lives, their friends, their family, and they're not spending all of their time trying to outsmart machines, or create new job things. Somebody has to create that for them, and that somebody's going to only hire them if they don't have a machine that can do the same task. I mean, some of these things, we just need a lot more understanding of what it is that determines the direction of technological change. So our project, we just started. We just want to understand, why does a company make this kind of software rather than that kind of software? Could we give them incentives so that they would make the kind of software that would enhance people more than replace people? And it, you know, what would it require us to do? Would it require highly skilled and educated workers? Because Roberto put a big stress on. I must say, I'm very dubious of the notion that education cures all problems, or education is a big solution to lots of things. Trade unions were a big solution to inequality problems in the past, and they were not about educating workers, except about, you know, that they could stand and go on strike and whatever it would be to get some part of the profits of the firm. And education.
Well, it's a simple point. You surely don't disagree. Complementarity requires capability.
Yes, but if the complementarity is of a very high capability, we have a dispersion of capabilities among us, and some people's capabilities say they're really good at certain kinds of tasks that maybe, for traditionally, it's been brawn tasks where the machines did. Those people shifted to service sector jobs, and they got out of agriculture, and they got it. The next phase is going to be is highly creative, finding new things. I'm dubious that most of us do that. I mean, are going to be able to. That's because the view has been, and it's among lots of economists, it's the superstar view. There is, you get a competition, there's one superstar, that's the person who, you know, Bill Gates is a superstar in that world, or in the movie business, it's the superstar. And all the rest of us are bit players. And if all the rest of us are bit players, I just want to make sure our bit players are making a good living. and are enjoying the stuff, because the superstar couldn't do things without the cooperation of the rest of us, and so that I put my stress on that. That's really what the unions did. They managed that. And I don't think I, or maybe a lot of other people, truly appreciated the extent to which perhaps our last. Up the last half of the 20th century really hinged on this particular institution pushing hard all the time for ordinary workers. And you know, in the American Walter Reuther pushed actually for worker ownership through the guaranteed annual wage, which was a more interesting way to get that. And
so
that didn't quite succeed, but it was maybe a number of years. before its time.
So just on that point, the development of precarious employment is, from that standpoint, a great danger. That is supporting the perverse evolution of the technologies. So this alternative program that we're discussing must have as one of its complements a set of rules that would master precarious employment and prevent flexibility from serving as a pretext for radical economic insecurity.
Absolutely. I mean, here's a clear agenda that just says, whoever really is paying for your salary, whoever is really benefiting from your work, the company, you should be an employee of that. I was told, I assume this is true because the person knows more about it than I did, that when a McDonald's worker, they sign a contract that says they will not go to another McDonald's franchise in the area. Each McDonald's itself is not the, quote, employer. The franchises are. But the workers sign an agreement not to work at another franchise. That is a monopsonistic thing. Ridiculous. I already know from, I don't mean to pick on McDonald's particularly, but just their example of this precarious kind of phenomenon. Your work output at a McDonald's place is sent to a McDonald's, not to a franchise headquarters, and they send messages back to the franchise saying worker X somehow was not producing as much profit as should have been. And so the information is all, so the definition of who the owner is, and the, it has to be. The most striking example, just as a footnote, but it's a day after WrestleMania, in the professional wrestling business, where they hire actors with great acrobatic and athletic skills to follow exactly storylines written by the studio that produces them, they are all listed under some legal ridiculousness as independent contractors. And that means they get no health insurance, they get no guarantee. The big monopoly that now is in that business actually is providing some of these services out of, I don't know, shame or decency for whatever reason. But they are independent contractors. When they're actors playing a role for a producer. So the definition of employment has got to be expanded to become economically sensible rather than, written by, say, lawyers so that the firm that actually is employing the people to do the work is not liable for any labor laws, for anything. And we've seen that all over the place, the outsourcing of work. Outsourcing or offshoring overseas is more difficult because it gets into trade issues. But the outsourcing of work is, that's something. Harvard has been involved in this situation where they were forced by students, people, et cetera, to pay basically the same wages and give the same conditions to the people who work in the DoubleTree Hotel. That is ultimately Harvard's is the owner. They lease to the Hilton chain to do it. The workers there were paid much less, had time periods that were like twice what Harvard employees would be doing, meaning they had to clean up twice as many rooms as the direct Harvard employees. And Harvard kept saying, oh, it's not our responsibility. And the Hilton said, well, if they give us more money, but they've given us this amount of money, and eventually pushing this through old-fashioned students protesting in the yard, the unions, and an accident where a particular worker was badly treated that made a lot of, I think Harvard gave in. But that is the kind of thing where you need is the big, powerful money thing has got to be responsible for what the smaller companies that are on the supply chain are giving to people. That's yes. Pure institutional labor law.
Should we open up?
Take your own questions.
I don't actually see, I'll think more about this question, because I don't really see the robotics and the deindustrialization as necessarily connected.
Yeah. I guess if I'm just going to give a quick example, let's say shoes are produced abroad in factories in some developing country, that's one of their big exports. And now we have, in the US we could say 3D print shoes, and people like those better because those are more customizable and
right.
that sort of path to industrialization export is gone now.
Oh no, I agree with that. To the extent of being 3D printers or whatever it is, the advantage of a less developed country was they had lower wage workers. That was the robots or whatever the machines are cost the same in every country. And if they are now doing more of the work, the poorer country has less of an advantage due to its low wages. And so you will see a shift back towards advanced countries of things that can be highly robotized. China, by the way, is 40% of the world's robot market. China is robotizing like crazy. We will see how that plays out. If you do more things with capital, and capital is the same price all around the world, which it kind of is, that will slow or create problems for the low-skill workers in the countries that they work in. You know, they'd have to find another place for their comparative advantage. Their comparative advantage is low wages. That's why they attract these things. Maybe tourism. I'm not sure what industries would be not face that problem. But yes, I think you've hit on a big thing. And the American manufacturers will tell you this. Yeah, they'll bring jobs back, of course. Not very many jobs, because the robots can do most of the work. But of course, they're not going to spend expensive machines and so on in the Philippines, which is not quite fully stable. It's got a slightly mad dictator or whatever he is. He's elected, I think, so he's actually president. But you do feel safer if the things are in a country where you have pretty good old-fashioned property rights. that your government won't seize it, or who knows what.
Yeah.
Yeah, so giving your response now, I'm wondering actually what will be the role of comparative advantage in the future where, production is so intensive in capital, therefore human capital, human abilities, and organizational capabilities don't matter as much in terms of comparative advantage. So would it be the case that nations would be more independent to pursue their own industrialization processes without pressures from, more advanced countries?
Well, they've got a long way to go to get their income levels up. I'm more than inclined to say they're going to have more problems because the traditional paths of development will be harder. But remember, the point is with the big robot and the automated factory, there are jobs for people. They may be the grocery type. They may be, if you've been in some big factories, the worker sits there and looks over the computer in order to see if anything is breaking down. You could imagine they will have eventually a visual robot that'll do that. But for the moment, humans are pretty good at that, and we have an advantage. And we don't cost that much. the robot might cost, there probably is a visual robot that would do it, but it probably is very expensive. And so we'll be doing things that we can do cheaper. There'll always be that, unless we get into an absolute advantage world, but it's not just absolute advantage, it's absolute advantage of exactly the same amount in every task. So as long as there's some things that we, as biological creatures, can do stuff, you know, better than an electronic creature, and we may have the chips in our brains that'll help us you know, tie together. There's a whole bunch of the robotics is based of, and think about the AI, artificial. They're trying to copy us. The big programs, the neural net programs, were meant to mimic neurons in the brain. And they study some animals and some birds. They build robots to follow some of the things the animals or birds do, because Mother Nature knows pretty, all this evolution, we're pretty specialized and pretty good. And I'm sure when they do the prosthetic arms and so on, they're looking at real arms and how the things work. So I think it's going to be much more of an interplay back and forth between the mechanical and the biological. Well, to take the institution, I think that the most about it, these worker-owned operations, well, what they're not going to be looking for is machines that replace the workers. I don't look for a machine that replaces me. And so they would be looking, or this would be the hypothesis we would have. There is no study of how their technology.
I'm working on my PhD right now.
Oh, you're doing your PhD on this?
Yeah. Well,
oh. Okay, this is great. I mean, because there you have a capitalist firm that has a different maximum end than the typical one, and I'm predicting or saying our theories or whatever it would lead, they should be pushing a different type of technology than some other firm. And that would be great to see some evidence on that. And we know so little about how, the technology comes from the science labs, and then somewhere somebody transforms it into something usable, and then you get to the patents. Most patents are useless, so a lot of us think of, many people think of some gimmick, something new. The market doesn't want it. Just bang. So you could see studying the. Are the patents different in some useful way? That's a marvelous thesis. I mean,
but
really important.
Implicit in this question is a point of immense theoretical and practical interest. If we think of the institutional arrangements as, I think I turned my thing off. If we think of the institutional arrangements as designed, among other things, to favor complementarity over substitution. One of the byproducts, one of the corollaries of that class of arrangements is that they will tend to favor the development of our powers in a non-machine-like fashion. So just to go back to the point of the historical context, in Adam Smith's Pin Factory, or in Henry Ford's assembly line, the worker worked as if he were one of his machines. And the same formulaic repetitious movements. And in this idea of complementarity rather than substitution, the tendency must be the opposite, to create a relation between the worker and the machine in which the worker is an anti-machine, as different as possible from the machine. Because the more different he is from the machine, the less likely it is that he can be replaced by the machine. And right there, there's a whole program. There's a program of empowerment, of education, of the development of humanity, which transcends the narrow economic objectives.
The problem with that is that guys, my sense of the guys building the machines is they're specifically meant to replace people.
Yeah.
That's when Foxconn said we're bringing in robots because the Chinese workers in their big factory, 50,000 workers or something, were protesting and wanting better pay and better conditions and all this. They said, okay, we're just going to get rid of all of you. I don't know how successful they have been in getting rid of lots of workers. So I think the software or the hardware makers are going to be looking to make more like, that's more substitutable. That's what they want to do because we're expensive. If we're very cheap, then they won't try to replace us. It's fine, you're not costing me very much. But if you're getting income from another source, that's fine. Let me phrase this crudely.
And
we're not trying to build robots to replace idle rich people. And why not? The idle rich don't cost us anything because they're not doing any work. So we have robots that are focused to replace costly people in jobs. And then if people try to go do different than the robots, that's fine, and that's probably correct. But then somebody's going to sit there and say, oh, now I better get a software package that does this job for you. One other point for her thing is, and I don't know what the truth of this is, but you tend to think if you're going down a more complementary route, you build up more and more technology that you can rely on to keep going down that route. And so it's possible that what you'd be seeing is it suddenly becomes just absolutely dominant that technology is the way to go rather than some other technology that, let's say, demeans humans in its relation. That's a hypothesis. I don't know if that's true. There are a lot of models that would say that. So it's not like it's a
But the direction of technological change is partly incentives in the private marketplace, incentive of the firms, relative to price and so forth. But so much of technology or science is driven by public money and public initiatives. And those institutions also play a huge role. Right?
By the state, for example, its interest in defense.
Driverless cars come out precisely because the U.S. military wants not to have combat people on the ground. So it's directly the result of actually wanting to sort of substitute for labor. So that's and that's why DARPA goes out and has a competition to stimulate driverless technology. So that's you get there. So many such more examples. So DARPA never thinks or DOE never thinks about sort of this particular issue, the direction of technological change. It's really about saving on battleground troops or various in DOE, which is a big actor in terms of stimulating new technologies. It's about quite legitimate targets about green technology and so forth, but again, not directly with respect to this employment margin.
So then the implication is this project can't just be the accidental byproduct of these other dynamics. It has to be the project of some political force in society that has this idea that the technological evolution is indeterminate in its direction, and we can write it and redirect it.
That's at least a hypothesis, because we don't know how much substitutability there is. But I think it's something that needs to be pushed in any sense.
This certainly is when the government puts money down for a particular area of science, scientists go there. It's unquestionable. And different countries actually make different decisions. The U.S. is much more heavy in because of NIH and health things. We do more health, and less on materials science, where the Germans and actually the Chinese do a lot. So at a gross level, we know you can direct the scientific technological effort by pouring money. Chinese government just made big commitments to AI. And China is now producing more AI papers than the Americans. With China, you go back 10 years, and China was no place in that area. Now some of that is going to be bogus. I stick AI in my paper, as a title to get government monies and this and that. But it ultimately will pay off, I think, in more research. Also, one other point. The reason the U.S. has the highest fraction of worker-owned enterprises in the world, 10% of our private sector workers are in employee ESOP companies, is because the government gave a tax break to companies that choose that form as a social decision, supported, in this case, by both Democrats, left-wing, and by Ronald Reagan, right-wing. So there was this general sense of, oh, this is a better form of capitalism. Give money, 10% of the workforce are in these enterprises. So if you had some monies, I believe people would follow the path of money.
There's another way to connect the earlier discussion on socialization of robots with this particular area. We're talking about this at lunch, is that one source of public funding for technologies that are going to be particularly complementary to labor would be the public's share of existing robots or intellectual property. So you can see this not simply as being a source of dividends as direct payment for labor, but potentially financing quasi-public venture funds that are going to invest or are going to be source of funds for stimulating technology. So specifically putting money into this area.
The whole green technology has been, that's been the way that's moved.
How to see the demographic meaning of robots? Could robots solve the demographic issue Japan is facing?
Japan hopes they will. I would say most of the evidence that I've seen says that the robots currently are good substitutes for young workers, are more complementary with older workers, and thus, in fact, are a step in that direction. The U.S. evidence is also favorable to that view. And that's where I worry about the education part, because when I first realized that the robots seem to be helping older workers and substituting for younger workers, I kept thinking, but the older workers, they can barely operate a cell phone. They don't know that much about computers. You know, your kids can do extraordinary things with the new technology. Shouldn't they be complementary with the new technologies? But it does appear to be it's more substitutable for them, and the older people with more interpersonal skills, experience, seem to be benefiting. You know, it's also possible the older people have more power inside organizations, and they maintain.
Yeah, but just to clarify, education is often invoked as an alternative to institutional change. But for us here in our arguments, it's always just its efficacy depends on its marriage to institutional change.
Thank you so much, Richard. This has been a great discussion, and thanks for helping us have it. Thank you.
Thank you. that evidence is counter to the thing.
Richard, yeah. I have to rush off to the doctor.
Okay.
Thank you so much for coming.
Then you got the, you have a lot of the label.